In this video, I'm going to show you how to make better composites in Photoshop. Hi everyone, welcome back to another very exciting tutorial here at the PhotoshopTrainingChannel.com. My name is Jesus Ramirez and you can find me on Instagram at JR from PTC. In this video, you will learn what is perhaps the most important thing about compositing images together, and that is perspective. What I'm going to teach you today will probably make you a way better Photoshop user. Your composites will look much more realistic, and you will know exactly what type of images you will need to create great composites. This is what this Photoshop tutorial is all about: perspective and how it works with compositing. In compositing, you can get pretty much everything else right: lighting, color, shadows, and extractions. But if the perspective is off, your viewer will know that something is not right with your composite. I'm sure that you can probably see that something is off with this image, but you probably don't know what. Have you ever had that feeling that something is not quite right with a composite that you've made? Something just feels off? Well, in a lot of cases, that's the perspective that is off, and that is what's causing that feeling. And by the way, don't feel too bad if you're making these perspective mistakes. I have made them myself plenty of times, and I have even seen movie posters and advertisements that make horrible mistakes with perspective. So even some pros have problems putting together multiple images from different sources. But anyway, in this tutorial, I'm going to use this Photoshop file that contains many layers and groups that are going to help me illustrate how perspective works and how we can use it to create better composites. This is a small portion of what I talk about in my Compositing Made Easy course. There's a link to it down below in the description if you're interested in that course. And the file is provided in the course download. But anyway, let's get started with this tutorial. So as you can imagine from the introduction and the title of this video, the perspective is off in this composite. We have this foreground element and we have this background element, which is the beach. So the perspective is off. And you may have two questions. How do we fix it? And first of all, how do we find out what the perspective of each image is? I obviously have already masked out the foreground element, which is the man standing here. If you hold shift and click on a layer mask, you can disable it. So this is what the original image looks like. And if I hold shift and click again on that layer mask, it will remove the background. And if you look at the image, we have gotten a lot of the things right. The lighting works, the colors match, there's even some mud in his shoes that sort of makes it look like he's standing there on the beach. Yet, the more that you look at the image, the more you know that something is off. Now, before we fix the image, we're going to talk a little bit more about perspective and what it is. I'm going to disable this group and just look at this diagram. And it shows you a grid that represents the ground plane, this line here that represents the horizon line, which is very important, and right above that we have the sky. You'll notice that the horizon line is where this ground plane meets the sky. And no matter what image you're working on, you will always have a ground plane and a place where it meets the sky. And I know that some of you may be thinking that the eye level is where the horizon line should be, and that's true. Your eye level will always be where the horizon line is. But in the case of a photo, will be where the camera was when the image was shot. So when you look at images, always think of where the camera was pointed when the image was shot. If it looks like the camera was pointing up, then the horizon line will be low on the image, so below the center line. If it looks like the camera was pointing down, then the horizon line will be high on the image. So that's a quick tip that you can use to find the horizon line on an image. Now, it's easy to find the horizon line on a diagram like this, but what about in a real photo? Well, we have this photo here, and it's of a train station, and you can find the horizon line on images by following the converging lines and figuring out where the vanishing points of the image are, and the vanishing points lay on the horizon line. I'm going to use the line tool to trace the parallel converging lines on this image. I'm going to select red as my foreground color. Then I'm going to click and drag along the parallel converging lines to see where they meet. And actually, you can already tell that the vanishing point where all these converging lines are meeting is right here, right about the center of the image. And if I start drawing out my lines from that center point, from that vanishing point, you'll see that all the lines on this image converge to that point. See how all these lines are converging into that point? Well, we can tell that that is definitely where the vanishing point is and where the horizon line is. See that? And also, if you look at the image, you can see where the ground plane is. Here's the ground and you can estimate where the sky would be. We can't really see the sky, but you can sort of guess. If this is where the ground is, then, you know, the sky will probably start somewhere around here, which is obviously where the vanishing point is and the horizon line is. So that's how you would find the horizon line on a photo. And sometimes it's not going to be as clear as this, where you have all these wonderful converging lines that'll tell you exactly where it is. Sometimes you'll need to just give it a good guess, especially in images that have a white background and you really can't tell. As I mentioned earlier, if it looks like the camera was pointing down when the photo was shot, then the horizon line will be above the center of the image. If it was pointing up, then the horizon line will be below the center of the image. Also remember that sometimes the vanishing point may not actually be in the image. It will be outside the canvas, and that's okay. But anyway, so now we know that the horizon line in this image is right about there. So that's good. I'm going to enable this city layer. Notice that even though we're standing high up on a building, these converging lines will end up on this horizon line, and this is where the sky begins. So ground plane, sky. So that's the horizon line there. So in all these examples, we know exactly where the ground plane is and where the horizon line is. Now, I'm going to just show you one other quick example to drive this point home. So we were just looking at one point perspective. We have these boxes here. If you follow all these lines to a converging point, you will see that we have our vanishing point there. This is sort of like that train station we were just looking at. All the converging lines, and on a vanishing point that's on the horizon line, of course. Now, even if you were to turn any one of these cubes to a different direction, we would still get a vanishing point on that horizon line because the cube is in perspective. So see how we can just imagine that we had another cube, we turned it to the left. All those converging lines will end up on the horizon line if the cube is sitting on the ground plane. But what if we bring in another cube, like this one there? Right away, you can tell that this cube does not match the perspective of all the other cubes. And I'll disable some of these layers to make it more obvious. This cube does not match. We're sort of compositing this cube in, so notice how it's not really matching? Well, if we wanted this cube to match, then we will need to find out where the horizon line for that cube is, so we can follow the converging lines to find the vanishing point, and there it is. Then drag the cube down to place the vanishing point on the horizon line. Notice that once we get the perspective right, it looks like that cube is sitting on that ground plane and we can place it anywhere we want here. And if we want to scale in perspective, here's a trick for you. Press Ctrl T, Command T to transform, and you can place the pivot point anywhere on the horizon line. So I can even place it way out here. Hold Shift and Alt and click and drag on that corner handle to scale in perspective. See that? The cube always looks like it's sitting there. And obviously in this case, you would want to place it where the actual vanishing point for that cube is. And then you can scale it in perspective that way. See that? How it's scaled in perspective? And by the way, when you're compositing, you don't need to place anything right on the horizon line unless it's something very obvious like a road or something like that. But with organic things like people and things like that, you can, you know, go up a little bit or go down a little bit, but you really can't, you know, be completely off because then it becomes obvious that it's not in perspective. And I don't want to spend too much time on this, but I do want to mention that there's such things as two-point perspective. So where you have two vanishing points on one horizon line. So for example, if you're shooting the corner of a street and this will be buildings and each side of the building will have a vanishing point. And there is also three-point perspective. So maybe we're shooting up at a building. So you can see how we have two vanishing points on the horizon line and we have one up there in the sky. Also, remember what I mentioned earlier. If you're shooting up, then the horizon line will be below the center of the image. Notice how low the horizon line is. So again, it's like we're shooting up at a tall building. And we can flip this vertically. So let me do that. I'm going to go into Image, Image Rotation, Flip Canvas Vertical. Notice now how it looks like we're flying over a building and we're shooting down at it, but the horizon line is high. So when you shoot down on something, the horizon line will be high. And you don't have to be flying over anything to get a high horizon line. You can simply be taking a photo of something on the ground. But anyway, I'm just going to undo that. And I know that you're probably thinking that everything we've discussed so far are things that you would learn in a traditional art class. And you're correct. All those art principles are really what help you create better composites in Photoshop. When you're drawing, you're trying to create the illusion of realism by using perspective, highlights and shadows, and all these different things that we can use to fool the eye into believing that that 2D image is real. And in Photoshop, We may not be drawing the photos that we bring in, but we can still use those same principles to help fool the eye into thinking that we're dealing with a real photo. That's why I haven't spent too much time in this video talking about Photoshop features, because I think that the traditional art is really what's important. But anyway, another really important thing to remember is that you cannot see the top part of something if it's above the horizon line. So look at these boxes right up here. These three boxes, we can't see the top because these boxes are above the horizon line. The boxes here below it, we can't see the bottom because they're below the horizon line. So anything below the horizon line, we can't see the bottom of. So when you're compositing, maybe you have a stock image, for example, of this car. And if we wanted to place this car into this scene and make it look like it's really sitting on the ground, then we will need to know the perspective of the car. So of course, we can draw lines and see where the perspective is. But by using this example, we can sort of give it a good guess as to where the car would be. Well, we can't see the bottom of the car, so then that means that the car must be below the horizon line. Well, how low below the horizon line? It's definitely not this cube here because we can't see too much of the top part. I know we can see a lot of the hood, but in reality, we're looking more at the top of the roof of the car. So it'll probably be this first cube here. So the right perspective will be somewhere along this area. So maybe right about here. So notice that just by placing the car in perspective in this diagram, it already looks more like it belongs here. And by the way, if you're enjoying this tutorial, don't forget to click on that subscribe button and notification bell. If you have any questions anywhere along the tutorial, feel free to leave them down below. Anyway, now that we know all this information, let's go back to the image that I was showing you when we started the tutorial, which is this man with this background. So where is the horizon line on this beach image? Way up here. Where is the horizon line of this man? Well, it's right above his knees. So whoever shot this photo was probably under knees themselves and got a little low and shot this picture right behind his knees. So when we composited this person in here, even though we did everything right, the image still quite doesn't match because the perspective is off. So we need to do one of two things. We need to either bring the man up and place him in the right perspective so that the horizon line is right about where his knees are. And notice that just by simply dragging that man up there, it already looks a little bit more realistic than what we had originally. The other thing that we can do is bring the background down so that the perspective matches, like so. So again, notice that by simply matching the perspective, the image looks much, much more realistic. Now, unfortunately, that doesn't always work. Let's go back into this train image. We already know that the horizon line is right about here in the center of the image. If I click and drag that man right about there, and I can use that same scaling technique because he's too tall, so I want to make him smaller, and put the pivot point right about where the horizon line is, and scale by holding Shift and Alt, notice that he always looks like a giant. That is because the perspectives of both images are very different. And this is the technique that you would use to make something look really big or really small. Use opposite perspectives. But in this case, we don't want that. We actually want to make him look like he's part of the scene, but it just simply won't work. So in a situation like this, what you would have to do is either use a different background, a different foreground, or just unfortunately live with the fact that you will never be able to get him into perspective. So that is the downside of working with images that you don't shoot yourself with the intention of making a composite. And the last thing that I'm going to leave you with is if you are working with objects that are not organic, so not people or animals, and you're working with something like a car, a building, or something like that, there are things that you can do to change the perspective. So with this building, I'm going to show you how to change the perspective. So select it from the Layers panel and then go into Edit, Perspective Warp, and click on one of the corners of the building, then click and drag the points on the grid to match the side of the building. So just match the corners. And by the way, I'm using a smart object. So this technique works with smart objects so you can work non-destructively. And then you can create another grid for the other face and snap them to the original face like so. It snaps in the bottom as well. Make sure you get the other side and click on the warp button in the options bar. And you can click and drag these points to distort the building so that it matches the perspective of the scene. I'm trying to make it seem as if the converging lines of the building will meet at the horizon line. Also, you can click on this icon here to straighten those lines and continue moving the points. Another thing that you can do is hold Shift, Click on the line, it will highlight in yellow, and that will allow you to move both points at the same time. The perspective is much better than it was originally. I can go back into the smart object, disable the effects, before and after, and I can double click on the perspective warp label to bring those points back and continue adjusting them if need be, but I don't really need to, so I'm just going to press the escape key to cancel out of the perspective warp. And this is actually the same technique that I used to fix the perspective of the crate in the introduction. If you want to learn more about perspective and compositing, then don't forget to check out my course on compositing, where I go on much more detail on perspective and many other things about compositing. And that's it. Don't forget to click on that subscribe button. Thank you so much for watching, and I will talk to you again in the next tutorial.